blinding light started sort of like more like descending in the center, and the room in where they were started getting lighter and lighter, and the even it was blinding to my consciousness, and my consciousness was getting pulled towards this light, and this was descending, and my consciousness was going more towards it. As it got closer and closer, a figure appeared, and that figure, I remember my consciousness saw it, like, this again, there's no words for it. It was beloved Master Living Yeshua, the Christ, but he's not known as Jesus, and it, like how it is on earth, it's Yeshua.
I'd like to welcome to the show Reverend Honi Borden. How are you doing, honey?
Wonderful. Thank you so much for having me, Alex.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. I'm excited to talk to you about your interesting journeys on the other side, and with your near-death experiences and all the pretty remarkable stories that you have to tell us today. But my first question was, what was your life like before you had your first near-death experience?
Well, my journey, my first near-death experience was at the age of 7 in a mm-hmm. fatal car crash. So the journey really started relatively early on. And in that car crash, I was with my parents in the Middle East where I grew up. And we were going to see one of the ancient ruins of Persepolis, which I had quite a bit of fascinations with, because I would always draw these ancient ruins ever since I started being able to draw. And my parents finally wanted to take me there. And on the way there, the night before, I had a horrible dream. My mother had a horrible dream. And that day that we were driving, we ended up having a fatal car crash, a head-on collision. I was 7 at that time. And it was in the middle of a desert and nobody really there. During that time, it was after the 1979 revolution. So people weren't traveling as much, and because there was a shortage in oil and what have you. So people would put gasoline in the back of the car to travel. Otherwise you have to wait 2 or 3 days behind the gasoline stations to be able to go anywhere. So in this fatal car crash, it was really horrific because I was in the back seat, and the way the head-on collision happened, my parents were severely damaged. My father had gone into the window. My mother, the wheel of the car had broken into her face. There was smoke coming out, things everywhere. Everything was smushed. I could see the other car that, you know, they had that had a really horrific impact. So in that experience, in a split of a second, I had what's called a mystical experience. But when we experience such things, they're no longer mystical. They're actually our natural state of beingness. So I was able to transcend out of my body, this larger being, and while my little body was still there, and I was able to observe from both that essence and also the tiny body of a 7-year-old. And then I was able to, at a point where I was screaming, really frightened that the car was going to blow up because of the smoke coming out, I was able to experience this incredible supernatural power where everything became weightless, and I was able to, in a weightless state, open the door like there was no effort. Meanwhile, I was screaming before, but I couldn't even do anything. I was trapped in the car. So make a long story short, I was able to bring myself out effortlessly and lift my father with one hand, pull him out of the car, open it, and pull him on the side of the road. And I thought my mother was dead because of all the blood and the way the wheel was broken in her face. So my journey really began there, because I was able to experience in that mystical experience who I was, the truth of what I am, not just this little body, but the full essence of universal consciousness at that time was shown to me with what is possible, what is capable, and it's not a miracle. We actually have these gifts. So with that, the journey began with me being able to see beings going in and out of the world, and in and out of the walls, like spirits, you know, loved ones and what have you, other ones. And I was able to experiencing angels and ascended masters very, very early on, and being able to have some other interesting experiences, such as hearing the sound of the flowers. It was so beautiful because I could see flowers, and I could see the rhythm of their musical tones and also hear it. And I thought all of these were natural, only to learn they weren't quite natural, and other people couldn't experience them. So the journey really started
in that car crash
as the first awakening.
So then let me ask you, before that, your first 7 years, were you a spiritual family? Was this kind of information talked about? Were you in a different religion and this came as a shock to you? What was before?
Thank you for that question. So my mother's side, they are healers. They, especially my grandmother's side, they practiced some folk medicine, you know, healing and herbs and what have you. And my mom was not into it. Both my parents were not practicing Muslims, but their families were. So that was on that side. But before the age of this, I also had much earlier on another near-death experience. But that was when I had pneumonia at 6 months old in the hospital. So that called me that I was getting ready to die. But that was very early on. I have just a few faint memories of that one. So with these, you have to understand, in the Middle East, anything of these things is not really accepted, because the Islamic, you know, just the religion looks at any of these things kind of like from a, they call it jinns, like they're evils and what have you. They don't embrace this. So I would have these experiences. My grandmother would embrace it, and I would be able to have also communication with those who had crossed over, especially like my great grandmother. And I remember the day my great grandmother transitioned, and we had gone to for the burial, because it has to be done in 24 hours. And I was walking with my mom, and they're all mourning. You know, it's really sad. They have to go take the body in a white cloth and put it in the ground. And meanwhile, my great-grandmother was walking with me on the side, and I'm trying to pull my mom, saying, "Mom, she's right here. She's not, that's not her. This is her. Talk to her." But they couldn't. And it wasn't fully embraced in any way, I have to say. Yet I had a lot of these experiences, and it was uncomfortable for school, because I had, they would call it imaginary friends, but there was a blue being with me ever since after that, a very tall blue being, which later I discovered who it was. And it was my guardian. I did everything. He was there with everything I did. So it caused problem in school quite a bit. And my parents just didn't know what to do, especially because I had other experiences. I would tell them I came from here. I'm trying to explain to them. And I remember 5 years old telling my parents, I came to help the people of Earth, like just so frustrated. And they're like, what do you mean? I'm like, but I came to help the people of Earth. So all of these were a little bit behind the scene.
So it's really fascinating, because I've never had a Muslim who's had a, or someone in the Middle East with a Muslim background in one way, shape, or form have a near-death experience or multiple near-death experiences. Because in my culture, where I was raised Latino, I'm Cuban, so it's kind of embedded in our culture from a very early, I mean, we're talking about hundreds and hundreds of years ago when Spain came over to Latin America. It's in the fabric. It's still not mainstream in the Latino culture, but it's except, you know, oh yeah, there's a grandma who's a, you know, una bruja, una brujo, and these kind of ideas. But in the Muslim world, I had to imagine that it's just not, you can't even begin. Even in the Jewish faith, and I'm no expert in the Jewish faith, but even in the Jewish faith, there is mystical aspects to Judaism that go back thousands of years. Right. And same thing for Catholicism and right. Christianity. But in Muslim, is there any mystical aspects?
Yes, Sufism is also like that. But my family is exception because my mother's side were all, like when I say healers, because it was always helping others. And they did a lot with herbs. Herbs was a lot, especially yeah. with teas and what have you. And my mother's side is the Kurdish. And my father, they're Iranians. And so one of the things that was really part of them was to create changes with not spells, not magic, but they knew how to create changes. And it was part of their the way that we're very connected to earth. So there's that deep shamanic aspect, if you want to call it. They were part of that. They're mountain people. They were very much part of the land. And also they were part of understanding the wisdom, the nature of the land. So that was very much part of my mother's side. But my mother didn't embrace it. She didn't want to go more in that direction. And I grew up with my grandmother. So I feel like there was that support. But my mother, just to fast forward, my mother always was able to sort of at nighttime when she would speak, it was always known that she would speak, but she happened to speak with those who had crossed over, and she was always scared of this. So never wanted to talk about it at all. So when my journey began really taking off, being able to share this, it was all open. I didn't know any different, obviously. But it was difficult because in that side of the world, they want to kind of, you make people really uncomfortable, because especially the blue being with me, my parents were thinking maybe it's imagination, but for me it was not imagination. I needed him to sleep here. I needed him to sit next to here. And in school, so school became a huge problem when I was in elementary school. They would call, because the kids, the parents of the kids would say she's bringing djinns or like spirits, you know. But for me, I could see their relatives, I could see their uncles, I could see their grandfathers, grandmothers next to them, and I couldn't understand why they couldn't see them. Well, until this day.
But let me ask you, such a young child having these abilities, how did you deal with this psychologically? For you, it's just a normal part of life, I'm assuming. It sounds like that's the way it is. But all of this kind of negative attention that you're getting from people around you, your community, your family, something, all of this, how did you deal with that?
It was really hard, Alex, because I could see things so clearly. I could see both the good spirits and the bad spirits. I could see those that were coming in to the house and they did not have good intention. And I would attempt to communicate that, but I was not supported, just like many others. These gifts were not supported. And years later, I understood why, but what it did, it shut me down. So I could see clearly through people. I could see the structures of what they were made of at a level that it's kind of like a matrix, like if you know the movie Matrix, like at that level, but I didn't have the support for the language in communication. So I did shut down. And also during that time, please understand that in the Middle East, in Iran, it was the Iran-Iraq war. So we were dealing with the airplanes and the bombings and the revolution had happened. So there was a lot of trauma, and I incarnated it into a very, a family where the severe trauma was part of my journey. So all of these were taking place behind the scene and not the voice to be able to communicate it. Yet, however, I do have to share this. The times where we had to go, for example, when they would shut the lights off through the town because the war airplanes would come and you wouldn't know where they would drop the bombs. You know, when we would go into neighbor's house, we all would grab a pillow or something and wait. We didn't know whether we would live or die the next day. We would just wait. I remember there was this joy in me, though, at the same time. I wasn't afraid. And this being, the blue being, was with me. And this is a very significant part because of my NDE later. And I wasn't afraid, Alex. It was, I couldn't fully express everything because they couldn't understand me. So for a very long time, as my journey began, I became feeling like I'm alienated because I don't belong. They don't understand me. I'm really weird and outcast and strange and all of that. So I shut everything down. We migrated to the US, couldn't speak English, you know, had to start everything new. And then that was on itself awful through middle school, but I could see things, but I don't want this world anymore. I don't want to interact. I don't want to see any more angels. I don't want just horrible things that are happening on earth. I just don't want it. So I just shut down as much as I possibly could. Until my father, when I was 21, in a tragic, fatal car crash, he died, and then it blasted open. I had to open these doors again, and it was rough. I didn't want to. I had experienced too much. And
Well, so let me ask, so then, when was the next near-death experience, or the next significant near-death experience in your life?
Okay, so the major one after this was in 2012, January 8th, 2012. So if I can backtrack for just a minute with you, in my 20s, when my father transitioned, that door opened because then he started communicating from other side, and I had shut this door very tight since we migrated in the US. I just didn't want it, and I was forced to communicate. So then I was very angry, I was very bitter, and I became quite depressed and suicidal, I have to say, during that time, because I couldn't, again, I was back in this place. I had this phenomenal experience in the fatal car crash, which 30 years later, I was told to write this book called The Day I Became a Superhero. It's children's inspirational memoir to assist children, no matter how awful you experience, you have this power inside of you that is always with you. It's God's source's power. So anyway, backtrack again. So during this 20s, I was suffering around a lot of this. So there was this battle inside of me, not again wanting to, because I couldn't fully be myself. So a few years later, then I had my first son. And through my first son, when he was born, because he was ill during when he came into this incarnation, during that week, it was a horrible week, Alex, of what the tragedy that I faced. And from such place of anger, I can't even tell you how angry I was. I was so angry at God. And I turned to God and I said, "You did this, you better have answers for me." And from that answers, that door opened up. So the door started to slowly open up, and I opened an entire center just to dedicate a holistic healing and also mini spa, because I wanted to find a way to educate, to help people to not go through what we went through. I didn't feel any mother, any father should ever face what with their child, that stuff, and meeting all this medical community, they don't understand. But what happened, as I opened my center, I began experiencing people from mediums and psychics coming in. Meanwhile, the store started open, and I'd been fighting it. I just didn't want to, because it felt so lonely. I couldn't relate. I just wanted to be normal like everybody else, but that was definitely not the plan. So long story short, during this time, I began having a lot of things started open up. So the doors were opening. I was having a lot of amazing experiences with the angels started knocking in again, the ascended masters. And I'm kind of pushing it. I'm kind of hiding it. And I have to say, I've been probably in more of a spiritual closet, because I just didn't want people to know what I knew. I wanted to be able to survive, because I was so afraid to be judged. So let me just go back. And I happened to be married. I got married really young. I was married to a special agent with Department of Defense, who was a top secret agent. And meanwhile, we were having a lot of experiences with the birth of my first son and second son with, you know, with plasma ships and some of these other star being experiences in our house. He had seen also the blue beings. And so these were starting to happen until January 8, 2012. A little bit before that, I was very ill. I became very ill, and that's when my heart stopped on that day about 7:30 p.m. Mm-hmm. And I crossed over into spirit side, and my entire world changed.
It was constantly changing throughout your life. It's been a very interesting journey so far. So what happened when you died, essentially? Heart stopped and you shifted to the other side. Okay, what happened on the other side?
Okay, so what happened, the very first thing was when I left this body, I was not in this body naturally. It was not physical anymore. It still was the spirit body. So as the spirit body came out of the room, above the room, and just looking at the physical body, then the physical body just looked just lifeless, just nothing. Yet my spirit body was so excited that it was finally out of that body that had suffered so much, had experienced so much pain. It was so happy to be free from it. So as it came out, it looked at it quickly. It wasn't anything of, I have to say, it wasn't any compassion, any of that. It was just the freedom finally out of that body. So then it lifted up, and the very first thing that happened is it sort of like my spirit party came out of Earth. And it was like around the stratosphere, if you want to call it that. Again, it's very hard to put this in the proper language. The very first thing that happened for me was this incredible, luminous, angelic being, this mighty, angelic, gorgeous, with a golden, pink, whitish ray appeared before me. And it was more of a feminine energy. And she put these three sort of like a dusty pink rings around me. And she introduced herself as Archangel Haniel. A lot of people don't have that experience, but mine, the first one that met me was Archangel Haniel. And it was just the most incredible, loving experience my spirit body was experiencing, which was very much looked like this, except was in lighter form. So from there, she took me to this, she kind of like lifted my consciousness a little bit, and I came to this place that had two sides. One was a corridor on my right that was my loved ones, my uncle, my grandmother was there, my grandpa, my cousins, my other two uncles, my aunt, my great grandmother, all of them. I could see them. They were like clapping, and they looked so radiant and gorgeous, just radiant, luminous. And they were so excited to see me. I was so excited to see them. But this archangel looked at me and said, no, this way. And to my left was another corridor. The colors inside of them was very dark blue with a bit of a silvery and a bit of like an indigo color. And she telepathically communicated that I had to go through there. And I had no understanding why. So I went through that, and it went really fast, like a light speed, kind of like when you see Star Wars, it's going really fast.
Yeah. Light speed. Uh-huh.
Exactly. So it went through that. And when I came on this other side, it was a different, complete different dimension. It was a different consciousness place where there was no body, Alex, anymore. Mm-hmm. It was just consciousness, and it was exuberant. It was gorgeous in the colors that on Earth we've never, ever, ever even experienced. And the, again, lack of a better word would be like nebula. It was like I was inside a stardust nebula, like the most exquisite exquisite, gorgeous, like I can't even describe what that was. So from there, my consciousness was risen again. So I was going through dimensional consciousness shifts. So as it lifted, I was brought into this place where it was more of a structure, and inside of the structure, it was a very large room, semi-circular, more circular, and there were windows onto my left, and it was all gold, and windows to my right, and there were 12 tall, very tall blue beings, six to my right, six to my left, and they were more translucent in color. Couldn't see their face. There was a kind of like a white hue behind them, no feet, they were waiting. So my consciousness was brought there, and there was the communication as they introduced themselves as the Arcturian Golden Council of 12, which I had no clue who that was, you know, like at that consciousness. But all I knew when my consciousness was there, inside my consciousness was that, I'm home, I'm finally. It was this feeling of finally. I didn't know how I knew that, but I just knew that. I've been waiting, so excited to be there. So within that, I was able to, they brought in the six that were here and the six that was this side. There was a space gap, Alex, in between. And within that, they brought some kind of like a, again, lack of a better word, like a screen. And this screen started going through very fast, extremely fast, many, many lives. So on mine, it was 844 fast flashing lives that they showed me, very significant points in time of history and different incarnations that my soul had come in.
Can I stop you there for a second? Because I just want to kind of, before I forget, for a lot of people listening, it doesn't, if we're looking at this through the eyes of the material world where we live in, obviously a lot of things don't make sense. But the life review of all these images, or the lives review in your case, of all these images, you're able to compute and accept this information at almost an instantaneous processing of this information, as Absolutely. Opposed to if this would happen to us here, yeah. We wouldn't be able to even process this stuff. So you're getting this at a different level.
Yes, we won't even be able to see it. The way it goes, it's completely understood, recognized, the lessons were there. So much is shared within these lifetimes that the soul had chosen to incarnate. So what was happening in there was, I was being shown the many lives, but in that, I didn't know why I was being shown. I'm going to walk you through what was
sure,
being
please.
Shown. So within that, telepathically, the first thing that happened, these lives were shown. The lives, my life in Lemuria was shown very specifically. The work that I was doing with breath. So since this 30 years, I'm teaching meditation and breath in this incarnation. So finally, this was understood why in that incarnation. The life in Atlantis was shown. The life, a few very other very, very significant was shown. The time when Jesus walked amongst us was shown very specifically. Many other lifetimes in between were shown. And as that was shown, then my consciousness, these Arcturian old elder beings, they brought my consciousness into the middle, but they wanted my DNA to come in there. So they brought the consciousness of my DNA right in the center, and they started reshifting things. With reshifting, there were these color coding sequences with keys that I have no language for, and it was readjusted, and they said something about the eighth strand, and at that time I didn't know what that was until, you know, I was sent back, which I'll get to that in a minute. And so a few other things like this took place in there, and telepathically it's all communication, and I'm seeing, my consciousness is seeing, not the bodies. And then after all of this, then this in the center, this blinding light started sort of like more like descending in the center, and the room in where they were started getting lighter and lighter, and even it was blinding to my consciousness, and my consciousness was getting pulled towards this light, and this was descending, my consciousness was going more towards it. As it got closer and closer, a figure appeared, and that figure, I remember my consciousness saw it, like, just again, there's no words for it. It was beloved Master Living Yeshua, the Christ, but he's not known as Jesus, and it, like how it is on earth, it's Yeshua. And he appeared, and it was the most incredible experience of that sight, that seeing, and my consciousness was pulled into this in the way then he began communicating. And very quickly he said, "You cannot be with us, my child. You must go back and share this." He took his hand, and with this, it was a body of knowledge that he showed that had to come back and share. And then he also said, "You'll be with us soon. Go back," and a few other things that he shared that I cannot share here. And with that, so quickly, without Alex, me having any opportunity to negotiate, my consciousness was beside itself to finally be there. And mm-hmm. and this feeling of home, I was finally right. My consciousness was finally right. Oh, this is where I am. This is where I belong. And just like that, I was sent back again, back in the lightning seat, and it went through those different planes of consciousness very quickly, dimensional consciousness, and dropped into this body. And I have to say, as it dropped into this body, it was not that the old Honi, it was a newer Honi that dropped into this body, because within 3 days, my entire body was healed. I was completely healed, and I came back with, as I came back, returned, there were these other unusual abilities, because I was then sent on a very specific planetary mission with 40 locations on Earth that I had to go on. So that's where my entire life changed, everything, like my marriage, when my center had closed, my product line, everything went down to me having, then it came the aftermath to then answer this mission, the call to serve this planetary specific work. So I'll leave you at that for now.
That's a lot. That's a lot. That's a lot, to say the least. So when you were, so you basically were like with the Council of Elders, for a lack of a better term, with the group that you were with, you didn't see any of your relatives or any other spirit guides.
Not there, darling. Not there. With the Arcturians, what the elder Arcturians that I was with, the 12 that were there. What is very important to share is, as my consciousness was there, I was also one of them. So they wanted me to come back to the part of me that was also there. This is very important, because when I was sent back to come into this body, different version of me, this part of the Arcturian had to sort of like reunite, come back, so that it can deliver this planetary mission, which I'll get to in a second. And I also want to share that blue being that was with me since I experienced as a child, it was recognized, it was understood, it was understood that it was also one of these Arcturian beings that was with me, watching over, especially after that fatal car crash, that was supporting and assisting. And I had other experiences as a child too, because of the they had been around, I didn't know, but experiences I had, especially in Iran, with being able to see the plasma ships, for example, and telling my parents in the car, but they couldn't see what I could see. So after this, everything finally made sense. Everything was understood. I also skipped this part, which is important. When I was on the other side, I was also shown, Alex, my soul agreement with my biological mother, biological father, my brother. Why Middle East? The Middle East was so important. Why my soul had to come in the Middle East in this incarnation to deliver this mission afterwards. So, and it's part of a lot of the changes, and why in a female form. So all of this was shared very explicitly, and details that finally the battle inside of me ended.
So you were basically shown, or at least explained, your soul blueprint or your soul mission or soul plan in this lifetime.
Absolutely. In this one, why, you know, for example, why this much tragedy in this incarnation? Why this level of hardship? Why my soul chose, especially at a very, very early age, to experience, you know, the sexual abuse at the age of one? Why it was so important? Because I will tell you, this was such an important part of why I became a transmedium, transchanneler. But how deep, as a total trans, I get into, this was part of the gift, because I was able to leave the body very quickly. So everything was explained to me. But what happened, the pain and the suffering in this incarnation that I don't like, just the unfairness, why? Like, just why? Why it has to be so hard, this life? Why? Just why? And there's the passion. I always had that passionate wanting to help others. And it's just, the suffering was way too much. And I knew, you know, for a while, I remember that I should say this to you too. I remember when I had my center, I had all these mediums and psychics that were coming to my center, and they wanted to tell me, they were trying to point to me, you have this other point, you have this other mission, you got to do this, you're going to be doing this and that. And I'm like, no way, that nothing to do with it. I want nothing to do with it. I'm a mother, I have this, I want no part in this. So fought it so hard, Alex. And I remember as somebody, there was another mystical experience had happened, that somebody out of nowhere showed up in my center and said that I have a specific message for you. She had brought something to me, and I'd just come back from California. I had another mystical experience, but I hadn't told anybody other than my former spouse and my brother. They were the only two that know. And this person came out of nowhere and said, I have a message for you. I was told to find you because you have to deliver this. And they pointed out to Abraham. I'd never known about Abraham. I didn't know about Jerry, Esther Hicks, nothing. And somehow there was a message from Abraham that had come to this person that had brought to me that I had never heard of. So I went to Abraham's first workshop. This is all before I had even had my NDE. And I remember sitting there, and I remember hearing, you're going to be doing this, but you're going to do it in a full trance. And I was like, I left. I said, there is no way, no No, I just came because I don't even understand what's happening right now in my life. So there was a lot of these. Yeah.
So did you have any, you didn't have any other near-death experiences after this, right?
No.
No more. That was enough. Thank God. No more near-death experience. So you channel as, but you channel as well then?
Oh, I'm a full transmedium, transchanneler. So I'll tell you what came after this.
Yeah.
So remember I said, after being sent back, it was a different expression in this body. So one, I came back with a few different abilities. Remember I told you the DNA. So So one of the things that happened is, as I had began my healing, facilitating healing sessions and what have you, this is when the Arcturians began communicating, and they're going to be training. So my training really began to show me different ways of seeing through the body. So one of the things that started happening was I began being able to see into people's bodies in like an x-ray, what was happening in the liver, what was happening in their gallbladder, like so detailed. I could see like hairline fractures and all of these things. And then I was able to see the geometric patterns of their bodies, like when it was, for example, in perfect harmony, which was in God's radiance, and when it was not. So then how to be able to assist in for it to come back into harmony. So some of these gifts had coming. And I was also, I had to get on the road to begin this planetary healing. There was, it's very specific. I had to get to these locations to transform the energy. And it was to bring this crystalline light into this planet through these things. So mind you, it was very difficult, Alex, at that time, because I didn't have a language to tell people what was happening. My family were, you know, my friends and family were, they thought I had lost it because I couldn't fully explain it. I knew I had to go and serve this mission. And they had told me it was a full team. We were going to be assisting you. So, for example, Saint Germain, the Order of Melchizedek, Master Lanto, Master Hilarion, all these other ones began coming in. It was like a full like house that they would begin the training. So being on the road, one of the things that began happening that they wanted to enter into my body for temporary to bring certain material through. And so this is one of the things that happened. But again, what was very difficult about this, because I had learned about other channelers, other things. And again, I was this weird, wacky channeler. I wasn't like for one entity, one consciousness. There were many different ones. They were all beautiful beings of light, because Yeshua, Mother Mary, Mary Magdalene, they were right there. So they were the doorkeepers with Archangel Michael. So that in which wanted to commune through this vessel had to go through sort of like their gate to bring the message. And again, because it wasn't like one for like, let's say how Bashar, you know, there how it's just Bashar or Esther Hicks is for Abraham. Mine wasn't like that. It was different ones that could come in and bring it. And I felt, again, kind of like isolated, weird in this realm. Like, why aren't other ones like me that could, you know, do this? I kind of felt like I have to like hide a little bit more until, and this became very useful, because on the road, I would go into these insane level of full trance. And the best I would do is like put the recording on the side, because I know it's coming and I'll be like passed out. So I had no memory of what was happening, yet all of these things were shared through me. So until shortly after my now spouse, who I've been with, he entered my life, and I was shown that was another one that he'll be coming where we can deliver this together. So he began recording all of this. So for about a two and a half to 3 year period, they would come in, they would meet him. My consciousness would be completely on the side. It would only see things imagery, no memory whatsoever what was said. He has full recording. So that's part of our book that will be coming out 2024, Channeling the Masters. And they want it to be word to word what was said. Very detailed, explicit information. But like right now, I couldn't do it because it's a very, very deep transfer. It'll take me a while to come back out once I go into that place.
Gotcha. So yeah, you can't do a impromptu channeling today.
No. If Michael was here, I would, because it's extremely, it's not like, so it's fully incorporated. I don't know. I mean, you have had a lot of channelers in here. So, you know, many speak, it sounds just like them, you know, all of that. Not in this, the facial structure changes. everything changes, and it's a full presence that takes over the body, and you hear that entity, that presence that speaks through. And it was really uncomfortable. And they pushed me a lot because they wanted me to go public with this too. So I had a 2 year of sort of more of a contained group of like 30, 40 to 50 people in different countries that would come so that they could come and bring the message through for the people. But Michael was there because it will take me quite a while. I still have so much to learn because of how deep it goes. And we've had information from beings that people don't even know about. Like, for example, there was a tribe on Earth before the Aztecs, they came through. They had so much wisdom about the trees they wanted to share. Like, we would never know this information. And so there's a lot of material, deep material shared.
So do you, when you go in, you kind of like just step aside. Do you remember? Do you hear? Do you see what's happening as your consciousness, or is just completely just
okay? So I'll share with you what my
process is.
So yeah. What happens is, so let me share this. The way this came sort of like with my husband Michael. So he is a body worker. He's an acupuncturist, massage therapist, and also energy worker. So a lot of time my body would go through this pain. I'm like, while he's working on me, for example, I remember like, for example, one time he's working on me, like I was like, ow. So I would like, ow, ow, this hurts, ow. And the minute that sound of ow would go up and it would go high, my consciousness would step on the side. And then one of these different beings would enter. And then me that's talking to you would not have any recollection of what was said at all. So, but my consciousness, like shrink to a size of an orb about 2 feet here, would see things in imagery, and not the imagery of the way we're seeing images, like very like cosmic universal images from the light stream, the explanation, what have you, the codes and all of that. And so then Michael would be meeting that presence, and he has a recording, so they would communicate with him. And what they did a lot of this for that period of 2 years, they would educate him, teach him how to do the healing bodies. Like, for example, for those of us who are one of the most profound, there's so many of them, but one of the most profound ones was, my gosh, when these elder Antarians that came in that communicated, those children that on this plane were, when they were being sexually abused, what was happening on their soul. So they came, shared how they would take care of the soul. So while the body was going through that, they would be with these other children. So it was so beautiful what was happening. So that the person could go through that process, because they recognized it was part of their journey. It was part of their journey in the earth incarnation. However, they could manage it better. So about 95% of my private sessions are sexually abused because of the journey I've taken being on the other side. I can see the divine perfection. I saw what was the purpose. So I'm on the other side. I can truly assist those transforming those severe sufferings, pain, and walk of suicide into like that the divine gift that it is. So Michael being part of it, you know, he was able to, with that, they were able to explain to him. Then they showed him how to heal, how to help me heal my body, what to do, all of this. So it's been this incredible collaboration between Michael and I, and to be able to, you know, part of the healing work that we do with individuals.
So when you're done with a channeling session, are you weakened or are you energized?
Okay, great question. Because of the nature of the way I'm a full trance, so like I can tell you, like, you know how Edgar Casey would sleep? Okay, so I may be sitting, but like my like it's like this, or it's like this, or it's like this. So my body is it hasn't as much relaxed because it's so intense. It's like as I'm plugged into 1,000 watts. And what happens is when I come out, when I come back into the body, my body, there's like a separation until it integrates. I don't want to talk to anyone. I want to just be, I want to go in a closet and just to come back in. I want to put usually a blanket over me. I'm cold in temperature. I literally can't talk. And it depends who is speaking. For example, the one that knocked me out the most, knocked my body out the most, was when actually Yeshua came and entered.
It's the energy.
It's love. Twice, 3 days, the love. And you know, Alex, what happened that day was he, through that interaction, when I crossed over, I didn't meet Muhammad, I didn't meet Buddha, I didn't meet any of those, the study. It was Yeshua, and it was the love. What he shared with me, he, through my consciousness, pulled into the I am that I am. I was able to re-experience what I experienced when I was 7 and remembered who I am, because I was able to, I tasted it, but as a 7-year-old, I couldn't do much with it until years later to go through many experiences so I can get strong enough so that I can live truly the mission and not turn this away and literally answer this call. So when that presence, when I got to experience the presence of the truth that I am, that crystalline light, what that love is, truly is, and that is what we're here to embody. And that embodiment that comes into this body opens the pathways of the pain that we have stored, not just this lifetime, all these lifetimes. Right. So it's an actual incredible mechanic tool that we're here to utilize for our own individual transformation. But it's been sort of like as a, how do I even say, people are trying to do it through the thought field, mental field. It doesn't work that way. Right. It is to embrace the depth of the sorrow, the depth of the hate, the depth of the grief, the depth of the hurt, so that you can meet it. And then allowing that love that you already are to pull through, to transform it, to transcend it. So I got to taste what is truly unconditional. When they says unconditional loving, that means you're really loving. There is no more judgment. And we can say it like this intellectually, but it's a whole different experience when you allow it to be right in the body. So that's the answer to your question in a long sentence.
Sure. So it sounds, from my experience, you know, talking to so many channels on the show, it sounds that when your nervous system is still getting used to this energy. And it didn't sound like you had a priming or a very long priming session where you were kind of prepared for a lot of this energy to come in, because you can, it's not easy to channel. It can be when you're ready, but it is the physical body, the nervous system has to be prepared for the wattage.
Yes.
And it takes time to get there. It sounds like you were somewhat there, but you're still in the process of developing, like, you know, Daryl, obviously, who does Bashar, he just on, off, he's been doing it 40 years. His body is completely attuned to Bashar. There's no, he comes out, he can, you know, talk, he can have a conversation. He feels energetic. It doesn't bother him. But you seem to be still on that process of dealing with these large energy that it completely not only wipes you out, but it affects you physically very well until you're getting better at it.
So actually, yes and no. So in my experience, thank you for that communication. And let me just reframe a couple of things for you.
Sure.
With me, part of it is because of this incarnation, has been very traumatic that my soul chose to go through for very specific purpose. And its purpose is to transform these very heavier energies, the capability for it to be transcended, transmuted into the light. So the central nervous system has been a huge part of it. Up until that point, it was this, these things had not cleared. So when I was sent back, as I went on the road, these other capabilities bringing these other capabilities, and there are a lot of those capabilities, to then anchor them, embody them, it met some of these frequencies. And with each, they had to open up, they had to open up. So it was like literally the can of worms that had to open up. And this is why some of the people I interviewed, many that had crossed over, they didn't want to follow the mission. They didn't want to take it to that level because it truly isn't easy. That means you have to be willing to face all that it is time to truly face. That means the depth of it. And within that, when you're able to face it, the central nervous system starts going through the change. So for me, it was a period of this 2 years of publicly sharing these different masters, ascended masters and other ones that had to come and deliver it. And then that period ended because it needed to, it was now ready for the next phase. And let me bring this forward because I was then told, because this physical body was able to interact with like a Melchizedek consciousness, then with the Saint Germain, then with the Yeshua, then with the Mother Mary, then with even like Nikola Tesla, or like we had one with Martin Luther King Jr. And other ones that came in. So this vessel, I was explained, is utilized for a period of time for certain information to come through for humanity. That was it. And it was a certain duration. And I was told once this duration is done, then is my next phase, which I have entered the next phase, to not channel anyone, anything. They utilize what they needed. They assisted this physical body needed, because now then that next phase, which I've been in it for the past year and a half, is the embodiment of the I am, the voice of the I am, that I am, that presence to speak through within its frequency. So it's the accumulation of all of Honi's incarnations, the angels, the beautiful spirit guardians, all of them coming. Sort of like it was like a retraction of all together to come into the body, to fully be in the body, because I always wanted to leave this body so that this full range can speak through. And that's where I'm at. So it's like it served its purpose, but now it's a different place now.
It's fascinating too that you come from a Muslim Middle Eastern background, but yet Jesus, I'm assuming, or Yeshua, was not included in that upbringing. So it's fascinating that you came into, when you came to the other side, you didn't meet Muhammad. You didn't meet Buddha. You didn't meet Shiva. You met Jesus. Yeshua, I'm using Jesus for lack of a better word here. But yeah, it's really fascinating. Let me ask you, what was the message?
I'd like to share something.
Please.
If I may.
Sure.
What is this is also significant. There were four times in my human journey before the NDE on January 2012, Alex, that there was a voice that spoke very short sentence, very precise. I didn't know whose voice that was. I did not know. Includes that day before my book was published on 11/11/11, but before that, it was at 5 a.m, this voice came, it is time to write what happened that day. And I just got up from the, I didn't know whose voice that was. I've been sitting on the computer, I started typing, I was transported into what happened when I was 7, and the book was written in 3 hours. I never wrote it. I had no intention of writing it because I always felt embarrassed. My English is not full, grammar is wrong and what have you. No confidence in that. But this was written, and it was that voice again. So when I crossed over, I recognized it was Yeshua's voice. So for some reason, this was there, but I saw the relation during the time on earth, what that relationship was. So all of this had come back. So returning back here, it was to carry, there's a specific mission that I'm here, as many of us are here, to carry this specific, it's a frequency. It's a frequency of this crystalline light. The way my consciousness received it when I was seven, and then I received it when I was later on. This presence, the omnipresence of the fullness of what we already are, that we are now here to embody in our walk of ascension, to truly live from there, because this is where the heavenly goods can finally bless each of us and bless humanity as it moves through us. This is what was so clearly revealed to me, like my own book of Revelation was open. So it wasn't, again, it wasn't, it goes not in support of Islam, it doesn't go support of this, because I still can't be fit into a box.
Right, and, exactly. Well, then, so is there a message that Yeshua wanted to put out into the world? What did you come back with as far as a message for humanity in this state that we're in, which is a pretty much of a, we're in a little bit of a rough state right now, and it's, but it seems like it's
from the human limited perception sees, yes, it that way, Alex.
Correct.
Yet the divine perfection of it is beyond perfect. Mm-hmm. It's correct. Very hard for humans to really see it. The human's lens sees through a very narrow focus that has not remembered who and what it is. So from that, naturally, it is experiencing a lot of the suffering, just as I had. I couldn't, for a long time, I couldn't understand why so much trauma and suffering. I like just too much, until on the other side of it, being able to experience the divine perfection as a soul choosing to go through this, so that the lens of compassion completely can open up. And this frequency of grace, what is really grace? We talk about grace, but people don't know what grace is. When you know what grace is, when you are living your life from that lens of grace, it's pure love. And the pure love is not a human love, my dear. It is a divine love that is here to bless this embodied incarnation, also everything and everyone through it, the way it emanates, the way it uplifts, the way it moves that suffering into lightness. It's an upliftment energy.
Now, my dear, I'm going to ask you a few questions to ask all my guests.
Yes.
How do you define living a fulfilled life?
It's exactly this for me. For me, is to allow that mighty essence, that gracious essence that we already are, we created from, to be allowed in this human vessel, to bless it, really bless it in its love, and bless everyone that comes to its path. That to me is a truly fulfilled life.
If you had a chance to go back in time and talk to little Honey, what advice would you give her?
That brings tears to me, Alex.
I'm sure it does. I'm sure it does.
I would say to little Honey, from now, I would say, it is such a gift that you can feel the depth that you can feel. This is one of your most profound gifts that you'll do so much good with. Just allow yourself to feel. Allow it. And don't be afraid to feel the depth of it, because that's where the miracles are.
How do you define God or Source?
Source. is that omnipresence of the fullness expression of all there is. It is the purest of the love that we can truly experience and are given the opportunity to experience in this incarnation. God's source is the source of everything, source of where life flows, life streams, and the creativity allows into coming to here to make the changes, to alchemize the different ways. It's the source of nourishment, the source of nectar. That's what that is, the ultimate.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
To experience true joy, real, authentic, pure joy, completely allowing it.
And where can people find out more about you and the work that you're doing in the world?
Social media is probably the easiest. Email is a wonderful one, ascensionalchemists@gmail.com or honeyb, H-O-N-I-B 1111 at gmail.com. We're on social media. I am. Instagram is honeyb 1111 and also YouTube. And
And you have a website too, right?
The website, the new one is being built. So in the next couple months, we have the new one. You're upgrading always.
always changing.
Always. So.
Do you have a parting message for the audience?
Thank you for that. This is for I would say those of you who really walk the walk of not being understood, being lonely, being isolated, being you don't belong. Please note that has been a huge part of your journey. In being able to have the space where you can get to discover you. And from that place, you can really also support others. That walk of loneliness is no joke in this incarnation. And to know that even though it seemed that way, there were always, always angels, ascended masters, so much love around, but the human journey had to go through that. Have a lot of compassion for your human journey, because you're not just your human journey. You're so much bigger than your human journey. Just be gentle and loving to your human journey, especially when it's going through these challenging times of it experiencing loneliness and suffering, because it's a part of its experience. It will be on the other side, and it can experience it in a divine perfection.
Honey, thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your experiences with all of us. I truly appreciate you and everything you're doing for the world. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Alex. And I want to just really thank you so much for this platform that you have opened. I can't say you and others that have opened this have been really answers to prayer to many of us, because for so long we've had this experience, but we couldn't really put it anywhere. So here, finally, it seems like 12 years later, it's our time where these messages can be shared. And just so that people know that they're not alone and they don't have to suffer, especially if their loved ones have crossed over, especially if they're having these magnificent experiences. These are also the natural state of beingness. If anything, they're more natural. So thank you, thank you, thank you for this gift and opportunity. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.